Good morning. The first item of business is general questions, and at question number one, I call Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what action it is taking to tackle antisocial behaviour in public transport.
Minister Fiona Hislop.
Antisocial behaviour is clearly unacceptable on Scotland's public transport and in wider society, and we're committed to tackling it. The police, local authorities and other agencies are responsible for tackling antisocial behaviour at the local level, empowered by the Scottish Government to coordinate activities to tackle it. Formal warnings, fixed penalty notices, antisocial behaviour orders, alongside positive diversionary and early intervention activities can be used. Police Scotland and local authority antisocial behaviour teams support bus operators to enforce their conditions of carriage, and British Transport Police is responsible for law enforcement on Scotland's railway network.
Kenneth Gibson.
I thank the Minister for that comprehensive reply. A number of constituents have raised concerns that the Young Persons Free Bus Travel Scheme is being abused by a small minority of young people who engage in antisocial behaviour on our bus network, thus deterring others from travelling. Have any offenders had their bus passes withdrawn, and what other actions have been taken specifically to reassure bus drivers and the overwhelming majority of passengers keen to travel by bus safely that harassment and intimidation will not be tolerated?
Minister.
The member raises important points, but it's important to remember that the vast majority of young people travelling by bus behave appropriately, with over 68 million journeys by the end of May. Now, free bus travel is just one of the services provided through the National Entitlement Card, and the card is also used to access a variety of national and local public services, such as free school meals and cashless catering. So, as such, it's not appropriate for transport operators to remove cards from car holders due to the impact that that might have on other services. But the Scottish Government does recognise there isn't a single approach to tackle antisocial behaviour, and there are a whole suite of enforcement measures I've just mentioned and safe intervention. But it's important to work with partners on this, and only yesterday at the Bus Task Force I heard from different partners of how they've tackled this issue at Kilmarnock Bus Station.
Thank you. Question number two, Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and apologies for missing the start of questions today. To ask the Scottish Government how it is supporting people in Motherwell and Wishaw constituency to access mental health support.
Minister Marie Todd.
Over the past year, we've provided over £700,000 to support 25 grassroots community mental health projects for adults in Motherwell and Wishaw. We're also providing North Lanarkshire Council with over £900,000 this year to fund community-based mental health supports for children, young people and their families. We're working with NHS Lanarkshire to plan for long-term sustainable improvements to CAMHS, offering tailored support to improve delivery of CAMHS and psychological therapies. Finally, I'm sure that Claire Adamson and others in the Chamber will welcome today's publication of our Mental Health and Wellbeing Strategy, which will set out our vision for improving mental health, building on ongoing work in Lanarkshire and across Scotland.
Claire Adamson.
I thank the Minister for her answer. The Scottish Government Distress Brief Intervention Programme was launched in 2016 and piloted in four health board areas, including Lanarkshire. Distress Brief Intervention is a non-clinical intervention that provides quick, connected and compassionate support to people experiencing distress. Can I ask the Minister what assessment the Scottish Government has undertaken of the impact of the pilot programmes, what plans there are to scale up distress brief intervention, and what actions it will take to promote this service to people in my constituency, particularly through primary care?
Minister.
I thank the member for that question. It's a very good point. The Distress Brief Intervention Programme, the DBI programme, supported over 43,000 people since it was launched in four pilot areas in 2017. DBI is designed to support people who are in emotional distress, who come into contact with emergency services. And in addition, NHS boards can enable GPs to refer directly into the service. Two independent evaluations have shown it to be highly effective in providing people with timely, compassionate help, connecting them into local services that can help them to manage their distress and address the issues that might be causing it. So DBI is now offered widely across Scotland, as well as through NHS 24 and police and ambulance call handling centres. And I'm very pleased to say that we're well on track to meet our target of making DBI available in all NHS boards by March 24. Very happy to work with the member on ways to highlight the excellent service in her local constituency, because the pilot work that they did was so helpful to us in developing this excellent service.
Thank you. Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I recently held an event with the Miracle Foundation in Parliament to raise awareness of the incredible work that they do to support children and young people with bereavement and trauma. They advised MSPs in attendance that support services are proving extremely hard to access for families in the Motherwell area due to high costs associated with private counselling and therapy services and waiting times of over 24 months for NHS and CAM services. Despite the pilot programme, latest figures show that almost 1,600 children and young people are currently on a CAMHS waiting list in Lanarkshire. So can I ask the Minister, with charities and third-party organisations stretched, what strategy has the Government put in place to tackle mental health backlogs for children and young people in Motherwell and across Lanarkshire that involve these vital organisations?
Minister.
So the member will be aware of all of the work that's going on to tackle the CAMHS waiting list. And of course, one of the focuses of that is to ensure that we tackle the long waits as well as the new people coming into the system. And we're seeing, as I've said before in the Chamber, real progress on that front. But as well as improving the CAMHS waiting times, we have done a lot of work to increase resources in the community. And all children will have access to a school counsellor. Last year, in the first 6 months of the year, that meant that 15,000 children and young people were able to access support through their school. And I talked about the community funding that we're providing, over £900,000, as I mentioned in my answer to Claire Adamson. Around 45,000 children and families around Scotland were able to access support through that funding in the second half of last year.
Thank you. Question number 3 is not lodged. Question number 4, Kevin Stewart.
Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what it is doing to mitigate the impact of the cost of living crisis on people across Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary Shirley-Ann Somerville.
We have allocated almost £3 billion in 23-24 to support policies which tackle poverty and to protect people as far as possible from the harm inflicted by UK government policies and the cost of living crisis. We are supporting households by tripling our fuel and security fund to £30 million and delivering the game-changing Scottish child payment. We are also providing free childcare to all 3- and 4-year-olds and eligible 2-year-olds, free bus travel for over 2 million people, and offering free school meals to all pupils in primaries 1 to 5 and in special schools.
Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her answer, and I welcome the Scottish Government's efforts to mitigate Tory austerity and the Tory cost of living crisis. But can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what discussion have ministers had with the UK Government about the increase in interest rates and the impact that that's having on mortgages and households throughout Scotland and indeed the UK as a whole?
Cabinet Secretary.
Households are struggling with the increasingly unaffordable cost of food, housing and bills after years of austerity, a hard Brexit and economic mismanagement at the hands of the Conservative government. The Chancellor is also failing in his target to bring down inflation, and households are facing the impact of high interest rates. Oversight and regulation of mortgage lenders is a reserved matter, and the Scottish Government has repeatedly asked the UK Government to do more to help those impacted. Having a UK social security system, which is actually based on what people need for an adequate standard of living, would be but one example of what the UK Government could deliver right now to help people right across the country, and it is deeply regrettable that they choose not to do so.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister may be aware of research from Marie Curie and Loughborough University's Centre for Research and Social Policy, which shows the profound impact and difficult choices facing those living with the double burden of rising costs associated with terminal illness and the reduction in their ability to work, which is brought about by their terminal illness. These people are in a truly desperate situation. So how will the Government mitigate the impact of the cost of living crisis on those facing dying, death and bereavement?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, one of the examples that I can give is the improved social security system that we have here for those who have a terminal illness, and the more dignified approach that we have to dealing with applications that come into Social Security Scotland. And I think that does show that there is support that we can and indeed are giving to those at the most difficult of times.
Thank you. Question number five, Daniel Johnson.
You asked the Scottish Government what post-diagnostic clinical support is available for autistic children and young people.
Minister Marie Todd.
Thank you. We continue to invest in new developmental services to ensure support for children and young people meets the standards and availability of services set out in the National Neurodevelopmental Specification for Children and Young People. The specification makes clear that support should be put in place to meet the child or young person's requirements when they need it, rather than be dependent on a formal diagnosis. In 22-23, we allocated £46 million via the Mental Health Outcomes Framework to improve the quality and delivery of mental health services for all, including neurodevelopmental services. We also fund a range of supports in school, including the Autism Toolbox, as well as materials and training events that support inclusive approaches by practitioners across Scotland.
Daniel Johnson.
I thank the Minister for that answer and remind the Chamber of my own diagnosis of ADHD. So the Scottish Government has now completed its National Autism Post-Diagnostic Support, which included families, children and young people. But I am hearing concerning reports that it is not the Government's intention to continue that funding for families, children or young people, which compounds the very real sense that people feel is that there's a cliff edge represented by a diagnosis, in that people wait for years to get an assessment, and yet there is nothing there once they have that diagnosis of autism. So can the Minister confirm whether the Scottish Government is planning to cut this funding? And if so, what support will there be for people once they have that diagnosis of autism?
Minister.
So funding for the pilot was provided for a three-year period that came to the end and came to an end in March of this year. The £1 million support fund for post-diagnostic support will be directed at adults who currently receive very little local funding. And as I've set out already in my answer, we're already providing significant additional funding to support autistic children and young people. There's always learning from pilots, which we can build into wider services and support. And I'm very grateful to the National Autistic Society and Autism Scotland for work that they have taken forward. And I expect to confirm soon that we will continue to fund Scottish Autism to provide their advice line for parents and carers.
I'm going to call for concise questions and responses. I call Stephanie Callaghan.
It is essential, Presiding Officer, that the Scottish Government engages with people with lived experience, including autistic people and their families, and keeps person-centred approaches at the very heart of this work. So with that in mind, what action has the Scottish Government taken to ensure a range of voices continue to be involved in the planning, decision-making and the delivery of neurodevelopmental pathways?
Minister.
We have a number of opportunities for people with lived experience to get involved and actually work very closely with charities that are led by people with autism. We are working at the moment, as you know, on developing a bill which I hope will be very powerful in upholding their human rights, and we are engaging a great deal with people with lived experience. If the member is aware of people who would like to contribute to that work, I'd be more than happy to hear from her.
Thank you. Question number six, Colin Smith.
Thank you, President Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what plans it has to invest in the opening of any new railway stations in Dumfries and Galloway.
Minister Fiona Hislop.
The Scottish Government is committed to improving connectivity in the southwest of Scotland, and the second Strategic Transport Projects Review has recommended improvements to the railways in the region, which include decarbonisation of passenger services, improved freight capability and moving Stranraer station. At the moment, the Scottish Government do not have any plans to invest in the opening of any new railway lines on existing new railway stations on existing lines, and the case for investment for new or reopened stations driven locally or regionally continue to be considered by the Government as they are brought forward.
Colin Smith.
I thank the Minister for confirming the answer being none. I mean, after years of hard work and tens of thousands spent developing cases to reopen Eastrigg, Thornhill, Beatwick Station, encouraged all the way by Transport Scotland, officials there have just confirmed there was never any chance these stations would meet the Government's criteria. And to add insult to injury, the same officials say bus-based options are available, utterly oblivious to the fact the bus network in Dumfries and Galloway is collapsing before our eyes. So can I urge the Minister, in her new role, to look at the reasons why her Government and Transport Agency are failing to invest properly in the transport infrastructure in Dumfries and Galloway, causing untold economic damage, because frankly we're tired of being Scotland's forgotten region.
Minister.
I appreciate the member's concerns, and there are a number of regional investments taking place in that particular region. But can I say that 7% real terms capital reductions in our budget over the next period, driven by economic mismanagement by the UK government, is not helping the situation. You'll know about Sestran's own transport appraisal reports. Their own transport appraisal reports said that Bewtwick, East Riggs and Thornhill are unlikely to stack up from an economic perspective, and the benefit cost ratios for Bewtwick and East Riggs and poor for Thornhill station. So that's from the local transport authority, but I think we should always be looking at potential integrated more transport resolution, and I do commit in my new capacity to work with members across the southwest of Scotland.
Moving on to question 7, we must have concise questions and responses. Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government when it last spoke to the SFA about its efforts to make elite men's football in Scotland as successful as possible to everyone, specifically children from disadvantaged backgrounds.
Minister Marie Todd.
The Scottish Government meets with the Scottish FA frequently to discuss a wide range of issues, including the accessibility of the game.
Stuart McMillan.
Thank the Minister for that brief reply. The Minister will be aware of the two recent Scotland men's games televised on Viaplay, which is a monthly subscription service, in addition to the Scotland men's home shirt for juniors costing £50 and also for adults £70. Can the Minister therefore outline what discussions the Scottish Government have had with the SFA about televising our national men's game, again free or on free-to-air television, so that everyone across Scotland can actually have access and also show their support?
Minister.
Unfortunately, neither the Scottish Government nor the Scottish FA play a role in the selling of match rights for the Euro 24 qualifiers. It's a centralised process run by UEFA. We believe that men's and women's Scottish international football matches should be part of the crown jewels of free-to-air sporting events, but sadly, the UK Government have absolutely failed to act on this matter. We'll continue to press the UK Government and to expand the listed events regime, and we'll continue to work with the Scottish FA to continue to make football more accessible to everyone across society.
Question number 8, Mark Ruskell.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the pilot providing free bus travel to people seeking asylum in Glasgow.
Minister Fiona Hislop.
The Scottish Government funded pilot led by the Refugee Survival Trust and Partners in Glasgow commenced on Monday the 30th of January and will run until July. It provides travel support to people seeking asylum living in Glasgow through the provision of a 12-week digital pass along with information and digital support. Participants will provide information on how often they travel by bus, the reasons for their journeys, and how having access to bus travel impacts their lives. The findings collected will help inform longer-term solutions to provide free bus travel to people seeking asylum in Scotland.
Mark Ruskell.
Can I thank the Minister for that response and warmly welcome her to her new role in government. I look forward to working with her in the months and years ahead. Now, the pilot in Glasgow will show us exactly how life-changing free travel could be for people seeking asylum, who, thanks to Tory hostility, are forced to live on barely £45 a week. But we've already got similar stories from schemes in Aberdeen and Wales making the case for change. So will the Minister agree to meet with campaigners to discuss next steps on extending the scheme to all those who are seeking asylum in Scotland?
Minister.
Yes, I will be happy to meet representatives of these groups following the conclusion of the pilot to discuss how free bus travel can best be provided to people to help support them in what are really challenging circumstances. They are in a difficult position. They're not generally allowed to work to support themselves, or are they eligible for benefits. And the Scottish Government takes an inclusive approach to people seeking asylum, working to enable access to support and services on the same basis as other Scottish residents, where that is possible.
Call CoCab Stewart for a brief supplementary.
Thank you. The Minister will be aware that the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee has undertaken an inquiry on the experience of asylum seekers here in Scotland. And with severely limited financial support, it's clear that free bus travel will better enable access to services. Can the Minister outline what discussions have been had with the UK Government about providing wider support to asylum seekers accessing transport services?
Brief response, please, Minister.
So the Ending Destitution Together strategy, in that the Scottish Government recommends the UK Government they should ensure that the financial element of asylum support should reflect the real costs of daily life, including travel. I'm limited for time, President Officer, so I will just reiterate that the Scottish Ministers continue to raise issues which impact people seeking asylum living in our communities and push the United Kingdom Government for positive change.